I want to thank you for being here in our second installment talking about the Strategic Economic Development Plan for the Danville County Economic Development Partnership. For those of you who were not here last time or don't have good memories, I am Kyle Talente. I'm a Vice President and Principal with RKG Associates. I will be doing the presentation tonight. Sadly, my colleague Lauren Callahan, who we met last time, her last day with the company is this coming Friday. And so I will be taking all responsibilities and presentations and moving this ball forward, which if that doesn't suit you, I apologize. With that, I want to get into the program. We have a lot to cover, and I've been informed that my time has been cut short. I will do my best to move through it as quickly as we can. Once again, if you have questions for me here at the table, please feel free to interrupt and ask the question. I'll be happy to try and address it the best that I can. There are three things that we're going to be going through this evening. The first is the draft goals for economic development for Danville County. The second is looking at the workforce and competitiveness from an economic development perspective. And the third thing is going through the target industry analysis. So I'll be leading you through all three of those things. Like I said, if you have questions, I will try and pause and take a breath every now and then to give you a chance to ask, but we'll move forward through. I want to start by reading for you these goals, just so you understand, should not be taken lightly. This is the culmination of our work and all the outreach we have done so far, including the communication with as much elected officials as I've been able to meet with, that have had the opportunity to meet with me. I'm going to read them as quickly as I can. First one, and by the way, I say first one, I want to be clear, these are not in any particular order, but these are the goals that have been identified thus far. Optimize and resource an organizational structure for implementing economic development that maximizes efficiency and effectiveness of the key stakeholders. Second, establish a consensus among the implementation partners on the economic development vision of the community and the actions necessary to accomplish the vision and the role of each need to play. Third, develop strategies that attract more high-paying jobs, preferably with benefit packages. Fourth, positively impact the occupational license tax revenue for Boyle County and the City of Danville. Fifth, create a more business-friendly environment that encourages the expansion of existing businesses and promotes an entrepreneurial spirit. Sixth, diversify and support retail and service offerings to enhance the livability and convenience for county residents. Seventh, pursue economic development strategies that help maintain the community character and quality of life as an asset for Boyle County. Eighth, support the further development of Boyle County's tourism and recreation activities to enhance their positive economic impact on the community. And ninth, create better connections between education, workforce development, and employment opportunities to provide opportunities for existing residents to flourish in Boyle County. So the first thing I'm going to say is hopefully you agree with me is those are very comprehensive goals. They're very broad-reaching. They're very aspirational. I'm going to ask the esteemed guest here a little bit of your reaction, concerns, additions, removals of what you just heard, something that you think is an economic development priority that I have not mentioned, something that you don't think is an economic development priority that I have mentioned. Your initial feedback, your initial thoughts of what you saw there. Does it mean what you individually believe should be the economic development goals for our community? Yes.
I'll have to give it some thoughts. First time we've seen it, obviously.
Yes, sir.
Will there be numbers where it's feasible to put numbers as goals? Will there be numbers to attach many of these things that you're going to push, move forward with, so that numbers can be used to see if you reach those goals?
So for example,
will that be done?
For example, we want to bring in 500 jobs instead of just saying we want to bring in more jobs?
Well, they keep score. Kentucky lost last night 82-80, so they keep scoring in the game. And it seems to be the way that we seem to understand things to see whether people have achieved the successes and achieved the missions that they've gone forward with.
I would say it's
a target out there.
Truthful. To answer your question is yes, there are going to be numbers tied to this. I would argue that, but I want to be clear about that so we don't have confusion down the line is, it's not necessarily that we're going to bring in 100 new jobs every year. It's we're going to do these five things that are intended to bring in new jobs. Well, and did we do those five things? Did we do them enough? And then what was the results of that? And should we continue to do them or should we do something else?
And part of that is whether there's $7 jobs versus $10 an hour jobs. So,
correct.
So, you know, the quality of the job plays correct. Into that same scenario.
So. Absolutely. So we are going to set those goals. And I once again, I want to reiterate for clarity is, I think it's a real slippery slope to say, if you don't bring me 50 jobs a year, you failed in your mission. Because there are a number of market, climate, and economic factors that this community, forget about the EDP, can overcome.
Respect and understand that.
Okay.
But we've been in, you know, EDP's been around for approximately 10 years, and have we been, I don't think we've had numbers to go by, so can sure. we say we've been successful over 10 years?
That's what we're going to get into.
I hope we get there, because going forward, I think it will help us to determine the success.
Sure, success. Absolutely. And I would say, getting back to the discussion of goals is, we first have to agree of what we consider success before we can set a metric to what, how have you achieved it. And so for us, these 9 goals reflect what we've heard back from the community in terms of, this is what we define as success. An appropriate organization, consensus in what we're going to try and do and who's going to be doing what, strategies that bring in higher paying jobs, preferably with benefits, improve the fiscal health of the community, create the environment for existing businesses and entrepreneurs to succeed, diversify our retail and service options that we have in the community already, pursue strategies that focus on maintaining the character of our community so that we're not changing who we are to achieve success. Support tourism and recreation as one of our important factors of our community and our growth and our future uses, and to better connect the workforce and education systems so folks that already live here now can be part of that success. So that is not, we're going to bring in 50 jobs, but all 50 people have to be hired from outside the county because no one can do the job here. How can we make sure we have resources in place so that someone already here lives here in Boyle County, they have access to that job just like anybody else does. So I'm distilling down in fewer words the 9 goals. And so what I'm asking from you is, yes, that's what we want. No, you've completely missed the boat, or somewhere in between. I'm hoping not to miss the boat part, because then I really feel bad about where we're going tonight.
Can you go back to the first list there? On the second bullet, when you're talking about the implementation partners,
yep.
Can you just kind of give me some idea of what we're seeing, who those partners actually are?
It is the Industrial Foundation, Chamber of Commerce, Convention and Visitors Bureau, Heart of Danville, Main Street Perryville, Boyle County, City of Danville, City of Junction City, and Perryville Community. So Perryville, I should know this, I'm embarrassed that I don't, but Perryville's a city, correct?
Yes.
Okay, all right. I thought it was, but then I was fearing saying that out loud and people going, oh.
Soon to be owned by Jerry Howe.
Yeah. It's going to be tough.
So, I mean, those are the implementation partners. Now, there's also the Bluegrass ADD, which is a potential partner. There's the Kentucky Cabinet for Economic Development. But they're going to be more supportive and indirect partners rather than directing the roles and responsibilities of the initial group that I talked about.
Thank you. I just think that it's very important that our group here understands that it's not them that are responsible for doing the implementation.
No, it's all of you, collectively. There isn't a single entity in this community that can take this on by themselves. I'm standing here today to say not one of these organizations can make this successful, because the issues transcend municipal boundaries and the cost of this all is much greater than anyone's going to be willing to put into it. If that helps alleviate that concern.
Well, for my money, I think you get, for myself, you get all the primary points. Again, we've just seen it, so.
Sure.
Other may come to mind, but first glance, I think you covered pretty well.
And I will be very clear, we will revisit these next time we're together based on not just the comments tonight, but if you have other thoughts that you want to share with us, we will continue to revise these. I mean, they're a constant work in progress, And I also say that purposely to say they're always going to be a constant work in progress, because markets change, communities change, priorities change, and so you have to continue to look at this as a community to make sure that, yes, this is still what we want to do, because that influences the business plan.
I only saw one spot in there where anything was mentioned about workforce development.
Yep.
To me, that ought to be, and should be, one of our highest priorities, because bringing in 500 jobs is one thing, but if you don't have people to fill those jobs, you've wasted your time, basically.
Excellent. And, we'll, and in this presentation, we're going to talk more about that. But I say that to say, it's just because it's only in one of them doesn't mean it's not important. And also, to reiterate, this is not in any particular order. This is what hit my head as I was writing them down.
Go back a slide, please.
Yes.
I don't know that we've mentioned agriculture in here. Have I missed it?
Probably not. And I appreciate that feedback. Because I just had a focus group with the folks from agriculture, and there's some ideas that came out of that that I think need to be shared. So that should be one that should be added. So I appreciate that.
Sure.
So Jennifer, I'm assuming you're taking all my notes for me?
Thank you. It.
I appreciate that feedback. Mr. Mayor, pardon.
That's what we call it.
You have that privilege?
Or other things.
Any other thoughts about what you saw? I recognize the fact you're seeing it for the first time, but sometimes there are things that just jump out at you that you actually have to say right away, and that's what I'm hoping to get that initial gut reaction out of.
I just wanted to go back to the consensus among the partners and the roles.
Yes.
And I think that's part of where the confusion has been, in that this is just my perspective. When EDP was developed, it was handed off to EDP, and no one else really knew what to do to help them. So I'm looking for definition of the roles that the city will play and needs to play, the county, and everyone. So I think that's a really important thing that we
Good.
Need to
Well, understand. And I appreciate you saying that, because from my perspective, this public-private partnership really hasn't been alive very long. It's still very much in its infancy. And so defining how it works, who's doing what, who's responsible for what, I think is critical. And I would argue that it's hard to argue with that. That has caused some consternation in the past. That uncertainty of who's doing what and why and where and how and when. And so hopefully we can address that to a point where everybody's on the same page when we finish. We will address it. I just hope everybody recognizes it. And that's going to be, and I'm not going to sit here and lie to you, it's going to be, some folks have perspectives and visions of what they think they should or shouldn't be doing, or who, what we should and shouldn't be doing. I mean, we have a diverse group of people here at this table, and you're a small sample of the implementation partners that need to be considered. I don't have any misconceptions that everyone's going to 100% agree with everything that comes out of the back end of this, but is everyone informed enough to understand why this is the right decision to go, even if it might not be exactly what I want? Per se. And that's going to be a critical factor moving forward, because we have so many implementation partners. And I forget, it was like 80 people when you include all the different board members of all the different organizations. I mean, that's a boatload to try and get pulling the sled in the same direction, if you will.
I assume from tonight's presentation that these goals are coming to a final stage, and that you say there might be a few more gated. And if that's a true statement or position tonight, I'd like to see folks sitting around this table receive a copy, electronically or hard copy, to have a chance to
discuss. I would embrace everyone at this table right now sending back their responses to this, so that when we come back and talk about the next iteration, everyone feels like their voice has been heard after they had some time to review.
And then I guess the follow-up to that question is that these goals have been shared with a working committee to get to this point tonight?
These goals were shared with, yes, this strategy committee. They saw and reacted to them. And they helped me make sure I didn't say anything really, really bad that was just going to blow the whole thing up. So I just asked them to make sure I didn't step on any third rails, if you will.
And I think it's important to underscore, these did not come from you.
No, these were what I collected through all my research to date. I'm synthesizing these from what I heard from when we all sat down in one-on-ones with business leaders, our research, and looking at previous studies and trying to bring it all together and saying, here's what I'm hearing is community values.
I'm curious, are we going to get any paper or anything that will happen?
Oh, you're going to get a very big voluminous report at the end of this.
It's just starting.
Okay, I just want to know.
Yes.
My brother keeps us all in this. Well, I agree.
And I have one more thought. And this may be getting too specific, but to go along with the mayor's agriculture, I would like to see something about preserving our historic properties as well, or repurposing.
I would say that fits in with the character of the community one, but I'll make sure it's spelled out in there so that it's clear. But I appreciate that feedback. All right, well, I'm going to continue moving. If you have additional thoughts after the meeting or via electronic communication, you all should have my cell phone by now. So I'll be happy to have a conversation with you about it individually. Work completed today. Today we're going to be talking about the target industry and the workforce analysis. We presented most of the other stuff that you've seen above here. So to jump into it, like I mentioned, the first piece is going to be the competitive asset sequestration workforce. And then it's going to be what we identified as potential target industries for Danville Boyle County. So I start.
Let's go back to slide.
Yes, sir.
Two. Go back to one. Yeah. That was not up to long enough to read it.
Oh, I'm sorry. I apologize. I am trying to balance how much time I've been told before I get the axe, and how many slides I had to get through.
We told you that. So much time.
So at any rate, so yes, I apologize.
Let's clarify that too.
Yeah.
We've gotten this far. Let's not rush through this. You know, but everybody should be here to really understand, because this is the culmination of a lot of man hours.
We've all got skin in the game.
That's right.
It's fair. I'm
Phil Simmons told you that we're out here in 60 minutes. Don't pay attention.
I'm not saying anybody told me anything. I'm just telling you somebody told me something.
We're vetoing that. So,
all right. Very good. All right. So, in talking about the competitive assets, we start at the large ticket items and then we work our way down to locally. And so, we wanted to look at how does Kentucky compare. You know, when we talk about target industries and recruitment, particularly of large-scale businesses, is we're not just competing with Harrisburg and Lebanon, we're competing with Mississippi and Alabama and South Carolina. And so we wanted to look at how do we stack, because that does have an influence on what we think Danville Boyle County can be successful in. And so what you're looking at here is, there's a report called the Report Card for the States. It comes out every year, and it ranks each state by a myriad of factors. I'm not going to read what's up here. You can do that at your own leisure. I'm here to distill this into why does this matter for us, okay? So when we looked at from an asset perspective, from a competitive asset perspective, this state ranks very, very well in healthcare and is competitive in education. And you can see here some of the areas where the state is particularly well. I think healthcare to me is a big one, given the fact that healthcare is such an important industry here for Danville Boyle County. It's valuable that not only are we well insured, for example, but it's also a target industry, an industry that is driving our economy here in the community. And when you talk about education, it's very, very important, particularly primary and secondary education, because that's where we are setting the stage for our workforce development program. To whoever asked me about workforce development earlier, is how do we make sure that we are connecting our quality education system to the types of jobs that we're trying to bring into the community? And so I think that's a tremendous asset and one that we can sell, and it's going to be helpful for us, particularly as we start looking at things like advanced manufacturing and the more high-skilled white-collar jobs, if you will. So other areas were good. Our unemployment rate is one of the better in the country, and that's good and bad. I will not say that's all good, because it's wonderful that everyone's employed. However, we do have underemployment issues, but also if our workforce is 30,000 people and only 5% are unemployed, that doesn't give us much to offer to a potential prospect. And so it's great that we have lower unemployment. It's a challenge from the standpoint of how big of a company will likely want to locate in our community given the size of our resources. And I want you to keep that in mind, because scale is going to be an important part of my discussion tonight with you, which is we have to be realistic about the scale of the type of company that we bring into the community. And yes?
Is there any way to quantify the number of people that have rolled off the unemployment that
yes.
are no longer counted?
Yes. The challenge is, did they roll off because they aged out of working, or did they roll off because they stopped looking for jobs? And there is no way to quantify that, unfortunately.
Yeah.
We can make inferences from the age of the population and stuff, but I can't give you a direct correlation. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So, and then housing and home ownership, you know, cost burdening is relatively low. Affordability of homes, and you'll see in a minute, we did a look at our residential market here, and that is true in our community. We are a very good value alternative, particularly for folks that are commuting to Lexington, for example, is you can get a lot more house here for your dollar than you can up there. And there are also benefits to say, well, you already live here. What is there an opportunity for you, rather than having to drive up there, why don't you work here? And so how do we mine that opportunity? Also from a standpoint of, as I'm sure you have read in the U.S. News and World Reports at some point in time, that with telecommuting and distance working, it's how do we sell the community, not necessarily a job per se, but how do we sell the community to someone who can locate anywhere but wants to be in a community like this? So those are important things. So incentives is also another asset that we have. In our research, Kentucky is relatively aggressive and relatively competitive with a lot of other states. They're not the highest. We rank well in the Midwest. Some of our direct competitors are a lot more aggressive. Mississippi, for example, is one of them that is a lot more aggressive than us in terms of providing incentives. And that's important to understand, because that also looks at scale. Because when the bigger you get, the more that becomes important. And so the smaller companies start looking at those intangibles and quality of life issues, because the CEO tends to be moving to where the company is. And so from my perspective is, I think we are competitive in that environment, but it also helps go back to that conversation about scale. The other thing we learned through this analysis is that while there are state incentives, there's a big gap in small business. Those incentives tend to focus on larger companies. And so there's an opportunity here, because everybody pretty much is on the same playing field, is how can we as a community use that information to create incentives, and not necessarily financial, but incentives, so we can stand ourselves apart for the 20-person firm or the 5-person firm that the state is highly unlikely to ever get engaged in. And so while that not only addresses a potential issue where we can become competitive, it also respects the fact that we have a scale issue that we have to be mindful of as we go out and recruit businesses to our community. And you can see here, and you'll notice earlier, there's a reason why we talk about these here is those also fit somewhat well with our potential target industries that you're going to see in just a little while. Some of the notable constraints we have here, we struggle in some financial areas. I will say probably the one that's most important to me is personal savings and challenges that drives. It creates instability in the home. When you see the term up there, for example, underbanked, those are households that have bank accounts, but for example, use payday loans, or they get advances on their tax returns. And the reason why that's valuable is that creates transiency, and that creates instability. And so, number one, it goes back to how do we create better paying jobs so we can avoid that in our community? And number two is, what do we need to put in place to give folks an opportunity to be part of those jobs if they've already fallen victim to some of these issues? And I don't believe I need to tell any of you about some of the challenges we have in the community because of that. Business and jobs, the real big takeaway from here is you can see how non-competitive the state is in small business loans and working on small business and entrepreneurial development. That is a negative from the standpoint of we're likely not going to get a whole lot of state opportunity, but it's a positive of there's an opportunity we have to jump on something that very few other people in the state are tapping into. I'm not saying that people aren't starting small businesses, because they are, but if we can put together a program, we can attract folks who want to start a small business that otherwise would have done it somewhere else in the state, and say, hey, Danville Boyle County has created an environment for me to be successful. I can open this anywhere. Let's go open it there. And when you tie that in with the quality of life, it becomes an opportunity. And we'll talk about that a little bit more too. Housing and home ownership, once again, this goes back to the stability thing. In terms of the education piece, what I found interesting was we do well in primary and secondary education, that does not translate very well into 2 and 4 year degrees. And so from my perspective, that is another factor that says we need to be very cognizant of having a vertically integrated workforce development program, that we're not waiting until someone is 18 or 19 or 50 years old to tap them for workforce training. Is how do we start earlier? Because if 2 or 4 year college isn't in the cards for everybody, we need to give them a path at an age where they still could be influenced. And a lot of research and study we've seen through economic development is diving all the way down to the middle school level, not just high school. A lot of kids, by the time they're 16 years old and are eligible to drop out, that decision, that ship has already been sailed. And so how do we get them, how do we look at a workforce program that takes advantage of the robust programs we have, but then drives them down to get in front of children and their families so that they say, they don't say anymore, you're quitting at 16 because you need to get a job. Is saying, we want you to stay until 18 or 19 because you can get certified and there's jobs that pay X amount of dollars with benefits that you'll be ready to do at 19 years old. We can wait those 2 or 3 years to have a better situation for you. Alternatives, if you will. Some of the site selection factors, there's a periodical area development magazine. They survey corporate executives and site selectors to understand what are the most important priorities when you're looking for a new location to put a business. What I've done here is of the top 10, allocated them where I think we have strengths and allocated where I think we have some challenges and opportunities to try and improve. I would say, and you may disagree with me, I'm excited to hear about your comments about it, but when you look at it, highway accessibility is the second most important thing for companies. And while we don't have an interstate here in the community, I have yet to have a problem getting here to the community. Now, I have flown into Cincinnati, I have flown into Louisville, I've yet to do Lexington, but I would argue that's the same trip as from Cincinnati. It is not hard.
Easier.
Half time.
Well, I'm talking about from there to here. It's the same route. And I would say that you have highway accessibility here. You're not on an interstate, but it's very easy, limited lights, direct connection that makes it work. So that's a benefit here. In talking with someone today, I learned something new is that we are almost at the exact geographic center of the eastern United States here in Boyle County. That's tremendous from a distribution perspective. When you tie in the fact that we have an active rail line, the tie in the fact that we have a 5,000 foot runway at an airport that is highly underutilized, that to me starts to say, what are some of those opportunities that tie into those assets? Quality of life, I think, is self-explanatory. Occupancy or construction costs, we are competitive within the market. Labor costs, corporate tax rate, state incentives, and energy availability and costs are all things I think are on the side of Danville County from an economic development perspective. Some opportunities, and unfortunately this is the number one issue that new businesses have, is availability of skilled labor. And it's not that we don't have labor or we don't have skilled labor, it's that we don't have a lot of it. And when you're talking about 250 or more job companies out of the gate, in my perspective, you're going to struggle to sell that against some other communities that are going to be competing for these jobs as well. Because as you get bigger, the interest rises and you'll get a lot more players to the table wanting to be part of it. Availability of buildings, that's another challenge that we have. What we market is what has been vacated. There is no new construction of substantial industrial buildings that I have been able to find. There's been some expansion of existing buildings, but if I need a 30-foot ceiling height, 50-foot span, roll-up door building, I have to go over to Lebanon, because that's the closest building I have available to me. And we'll talk a little bit more about how that influences us later. Proximity to major markets. We are proximate to Lexington, Louisville, which is good, but there are other communities, frankly, that are closer to larger employment or population centers. And I don't think this is a major one, because particularly from a distribution perspective, we are well located. But the reality is there are some companies that are going to want to be near bigger cities, if you will, and that's going to be a challenge for us. And then finally is local incentives. I don't know if there are any. And in fact, I have heard time and time again, anecdotally, that there are local disincentives for investment in our community. And we'll talk about that in just a while. This is just showing you how those site selection factors we just talked about have changed from 2010. I always want to look at the longitudinal impacts. What's gotten more important, what's gotten less important. I think the biggest takeaway for me here is how availability of skilled labor has steadily rose as an important thing, and stuff like incentives, while important, have dropped. I think companies recognize the fact that they're not going to make decisions where they're not going to be able to make money, particularly when you start getting into the smaller companies, because it's really the larger companies that get those ridiculous things that you read about in the newspapers. But my point there is, it's not about giving away the farm to get activity. It's about being more creative and more targeted in who we're going to go after, so we don't have to provide as much. And let's tie together what our competitive assets are with the types of businesses we try to recruit.
I have a question on the...
Yes, sir.
I'm just wondering how you figure, take for example, quality-wise, how come it's increased 29% the last 15 years?
I would say...
What do you base that on?
This is the responses that came from the folks, the corporate executives and the site selection consultants that they interview. I can't begin to tell you why it has gotten more important. I would argue that there are probably, if I had to guess, let's put it that way, is the employment base, your millennial base, which is now pushing 50-60% of your workforce, cares more about where they live than what they do. To be frank, if you look at, you don't need to pick up, go on Google and Google millennials and employment choices, and you're going to see article after article about how their experience.
We've had several plants explode in that last 15 years.
Excuse me?
I said we've had a lot of plants close, and a lot of times it's happened. I can see this increase. I figured it decreased more.
The importance of quality of life?
Quality of life, yes.
Well, I would argue, and I'm not privy to all the reasonings why those plants have closed, but I can tell you from the ones that are in the process right now, is that's more a global corporate decision than it is a local community decision. And I take something like Panasonic as an example. That was a corporate restructuring that had absolutely nothing to do. We were a casualty. We were a innocent bystander in that, rather than it was something that we did or didn't do as a community to make that a competitive decision. So we also looked at some other quality of life issues, crime rates. I thought this was very valuable. If you look at Danville, Boyle County, you can see our crime rates actually have been dropping over time, just on a crime per 1,000 persons basis, where everyone else has been relatively stable or increased. I think that's a tremendous asset that we can sell from an economic development perspective. When you look at our crime rate, it actually drops down fairly low, and we're competitive with even more rural areas than us. You would argue the more urban the community gets, the more incidents of potential crime. We're actually going the other way, which is a testament to this community, to its safety. And when you're looking at the small business where the CEO and that CEO's family are coming with the company, that's an important factor that can be sold. School ratings, I mean, you can see here the what color is that? Orangish yellow, I believe, is the county school system, and the blues are the city school systems. And there are some very strong assets we have here. From my perspective is, how do we create parity so that we're not having a imbalance in when people do come to this community, where they end up located? And how can we, as an economic development organization, create strategies? And for me, that goes back to that tying in workforce development down into the high school and middle school level, because when kids see that there is a future for them to stay in school, performance goes up. Yes, sir.
Can you go back one slide?
Yes.
I apologize. You were talking about crime rate going down here.
Yes.
I would like to add a note. I think there's a direct relationship between the law enforcement attempt to do away with substance abuse, which is huge here, and crime. I think there is a direct relationship, and I applaud the law enforcement groups, both city and county, and everybody that's in it, that is really making an effort to get substance abuse under control. And as a community, we're trying to do it. So.
And I respect that. And I think, but from an economic, and I agree yeah. with you, but from an economic perspective, this is a selling point to me.
I totally agree, but it's not something that's always talked about.
Well, I think I agree with the pastor. Okay, but I think the community is working more together now on the drug problems and everything we've ever had. I think we're sticking together. I think we're coming together more than any other thing we've ever had.
And I would argue, if you don't mind me pontificating, is that coordination will translate to success in all facets of community needs, including economic development. So here we're looking at medical facilities, the very hard to see H's. the red H's that are up there, I apologize about that. All I'm saying here is we have more medical options than our size dictates. We are a regional hub for healthcare, and that's a tremendous thing. From my perspective is how do we parlay that into growth? Maybe not necessarily more docs and nurses per se, but there are a vast number of other parts of the healthcare industry that we can be a part of that we can try and sell as a community. And so, but having understanding how this works, I think is very, very valuable. We also, as I mentioned, we also looked at, oh boy, that didn't print well, sorry about that. Also looked at the housing market. What you're looking at here is the breakout of sales by housing value. You can see we don't have a lot of stuff in the $0 to $50,000 range, but we do have a substantial amount of housing that's moving in that $50,000 to $150,000 range. That goes back to that affordability thing I was talking about earlier. That's a tremendous selling point for companies that pay $40,000 to $50,000 a year, is that their employees, if they do have to relocate here, can own. They're not pigeonholed into finding an apartment like they would be if making $40,000 to $50,000 in Alexandria, Virginia. Good luck on finding a house for that amount there. We also looked at it, you know, from a market performance perspective, and the takeaway here is that housing is moving fairly well. It's not setting the world on fire, but we are moving units in about 150 days, which is consistent with the market. We're getting pretty close to asking price, which is also an indication of a fairly healthy market here. And there is diversity. The employee who makes $200,000 has options. The employee who makes $20,000 has options. And we got a lot of broker feedback, and you know, to boil this down to a couple of thoughts is, one is we remain to be an affordable alternative to Lexington, and that's bringing folks down here. We're seeing a substantial growth in the market in retirees and near retirees that are looking to take advantage of the Danville Boyle County quality of life and the lower cost of living. And that the assets we have, is the college, the hospital, those types of amenities, is a big draw. We also looked at rents. We looked at the rental market too, because that's important here. You can see we've looked at rent rates, which are extremely reasonable when you're comparing it to, once again, to Lexington. The challenge here, and distilling this into a thought or two, is there is nothing available on the market. In fact, I talked to today with someone who has a hand in that game, and those units are gone, and there is so much unmet demand. What I was told is they field hundreds of calls a day and generally have less than 10 units to show. So this is not a call to say we need more rental housing. My point is that there's an entire market out there, particularly of workforce, particularly the millennial generation, that if you want to draw them here, at least in the first place, there isn't a lot of option and choice if they want to start with renting. That's a challenge. And that's something we need to be thinking of as we look at the types of businesses that we're going to grow. So some of the implications, we are well positioned regionally, but we do not lead all of our primary competition. That's not necessarily a bad thing, particularly with some of our primary competition does give the farm away, if you will, but it's a consideration that we need to make. The economic development fundamentals are really good here in Boyle County. I think that translates into the resources that we have. We've been able to be successful with those, particularly when you look at expansions and reinvestments. Some of the challenges, though, is we don't have the variety or the depth of market to really experience all that growth. We need to distinguish ourselves from the pack. I put in here somewhere, and I'll probably say it again. Boyle County made its success on being an alternative to Lexington, Louisville, and saying we are just as good. We have the same access to resources. You could be in Lexington real soon, and you could be here and save some money. Our neighbors have caught wind of that and are using our own model against us. Don't kid yourself if you don't think that Lebanon is saying, you can be here in Lebanon, you can go live in Boyle County and have access to downtown Danville, and we'll save you tons of money. And so, as I've been telling people today, is we've been boiled by other people. And so my point about that is, we need to distinguish ourselves in the market. Rather than trying to continue to be that value alternative for everything, we have to figure out a way to make ourselves more valuable, not less expensive. And I hope that's clear what I'm trying to say with that. And then branding study revealed one of the most notable challenges is external awareness. And I couldn't agree more. The successes that we have had in this community, in certain periodicals, I would share an article that talked about the accolades, and I looked at the 2016 report card that Ben presented not too long ago, and there's tremendous things going on here, but it's not universally known. And sadly, it's not just universally known outside of Boyle County, it's also not universally known inside of Boyle County. And so we have to get that message out there. We have to be more proactive. We have to be more aggressive with selling what we have, because prospects, and I know I talked about this with you before, prospects vet this community before they ever contact this community. And if that information is not out there for them to see on your websites and in the ether, you can be missing opportunities that you never knew even had the potential to be here. And so my point there is we have to get more aggressive in getting our story told. Defining what our story is, setting ourselves apart from our local competition, and then getting it out there so that people know what it is. And then more strategic and aggressive investments will be necessary to address the new economic development paradigm. Danville County was successful for a long, long time, where the private sector basically led the charge and businesses flocked, they fell over themselves to get here. And that was very, very successful in the 70s, 80s, maybe even into the early 90s. Like I mentioned earlier about, we are in our infancy of this public-private partnership strategy, that paradigm no longer works. Because the reality is there are communities out there that are willing to be the value alternative, and so the private sector can't afford it because they can't make their numbers. And so the strategy here is, when I say we need to have a building that is ready to go on the ground so someone can move into it in 3 weeks, the response is, well, who's supposed to build that? Whose responsibility is that? That's where I think we need to get to when we start talking about and graduate our public-private partnership, is to graduate it beyond just having an organization that we all sit on boards and have fun, is we all have to have our skin in that game. And there are ways, and we'll talk about that as we get down the line, that I want to share with all of you, that we can do it to mitigate everybody's risk. This is not, let's put $5 million out there and hope to God someone comes and takes the building. This is, how do we create a smart strategy so that we can help the private sector do its thing, but protect it from unnecessary risk at a minimal cost to us as a community. And I, there are models out there that I can share with you, but I think the reality is we need to get out there and invest more. We need to have a more unified inventory of the properties we do have available. We need to be more streamlined and friendly in our regulatory environment. I mentioned earlier, you know, it's not about local incentives, sometimes there's local disincentives. The reality is that we have neighbors that are much more proactive and much more streamlined than we are in going from idea to building. And we have to continue to improve our strategies and our ways so that we can be competitive. If you've ever worked in the private sector before, you know time is money. And the longer it takes me to get my building in the ground and my staff on board and producing my widgets or crunching my tables and making my PowerPoint presentations, the more money I lose. And if Community X can get me up and running in 3 weeks and it's going to take me 3 years here, and I'm not saying it is, I'm using hyperbole for effect, I'm going to go there, all things being equal. And this is one of the issues we have as being a successful, growing community, is we do have the ability to be more picky. We do have the ability to be more choosy. And there's nothing wrong with that, but my point is, how do we find that balance? So that we can be perceived as more business friendly, which can open up more opportunities for us. Workforce analysis. This one I can do fairly easily. There are very communities that I've worked in where I can say, you guys are doing a really good job on workforce development. And the reality is, between the state, organizations like BCTC, there are a lot of resources out there and available. What here is looking at education attainment, and we are consistent with our surrounding market and the Bowling Green ADD, which is a good thing. We do have diversity in our attainment levels, which then is diversity for the different types of companies we want to recruit. So we can be as effective with high-skilled white-collar jobs as we are with production-based jobs. And we have resources here available, not just locally, but regionally. When you look at it here, a lot of people get shocked by these slides. The red is white-collar jobs. The blue is blue-collar jobs. There is we have, as a nation, as a region, as a community, transition from production-based to service-based. And when we talk about, we want to bring more production-based jobs in, I think there's a case to be made for that. And I think there's opportunities. But we have to be realistic about the scale of that because of the availability, frankly, of labor to make that happen. I mentioned you guys have a lot of resources available to you, state-provided resources, locally-provided resources. I can't say enough to say that it's not 100% covered across the board, but this community, this state, has become very good at providing the resources necessary to make happen. From our perspective, where we have opportunities is how do we tie together the needs of our existing businesses and the business we are recruiting with customized training programs. It's not enough to provide CNC machining as an option. It's how do we provide the CNC machining that leads then to a job here in the community, and we have enough of it that we can use that as a recruiting tool. I worked in Onslow County, North Carolina, where Camp Lejeune is. If you're not familiar, it's one of the major, I believe, Marine Corps bases in the United States. They have, I'm going to get the number wrong, thousands of Marines that are leaving the service out of Camp Lejeune year over year. That's a guaranteed, proven labor force that you have available to you that's coming out right there in your community. The more we have of those types of programs where we can say to prospects, we're producing 30 X's a year, you need 10, you have your pick of the litter of people who are already here in the community that you don't have to worry about whether they'll come to Boyle County because they're already in Boyle County. My point of all that story is, it's not about having the right resources, it's about how do we be more strategic about using those resources in our community. One of the ways, and you can see on here, is that, and I hope I'm not stealing your thunder, Ben, is we are implementing, hopefully this week or very, very soon, a countywide business survey. And part of that survey is understanding challenges, employment needs. The intent of why the VP has agreed to do this, partially at my nudging, is when we know what people need, then we know how to work with our workforce development partners to put in place what they then deliver the types of workers that they need. So I'm saying that to say is that the EDP is already taking steps to try and be more strategic about how we get our workforce programs more set. I talked about the different programs that are out there. The state has tremendous resources that are available to us. And even in our surrounding communities, they sometimes offer things that we don't have. And it's not a stretch. I've learned in my drive to look at our competitive communities, it's not a stretch to go to Garrett or to Casey or to Marion if you have to for a training program. It's not like I'm telling you you need to go to Louisville. And so I think that there's a lot of opportunity there. But as you can see here on the last bullet, and we've already talked about this a lot, but I feel it worth reiterating, it's about capacity, not about availability. And producing five whatevers isn't as good as producing 15. And you'll see in the implications and the initial recommendations is, and I don't know where you are, since the last time I was in town, that grant strategy of how to grow BCTC should be an important short-term goal for economic development to ensure that that happens. Some recommendations, inter-organizational connectivity. While we do have a lot of assets, I talked about that vertical connection between Board of Education, the workforce training programs in the state. The EDP should be the field marshal of that. You can't leave it to their own devices because they have missions to run. Schools have to educate children. BCTC has to provide training programs. The state is looking at it from a macro perspective. The EDP should be the one that says, hey, we have this need. Schools, can we use this facility to have these people meet this training class and then tie it into these businesses that said they were willing to hire 12 people in the next 6 months? I hope you can see where I'm going with this coordination piece. It's not about creating more training programs. It's about making sure we're connecting the right partners to make it happen. Expanding our marketing and outreach efforts. Part of it is there's probably already a training program in place for a lot of businesses what they need. They just don't know it exists. If you run a business, small or large, you're not have a whole lot of time to go look at the curriculum at Center College or all the offerings at BCTC. And so part of what the EDCP should be doing is when we identify your need, show you where that asset, where that opportunity is, and make the connection for you. And then finally, increasing awareness of scholarship and financial incentives for workforce development. I mean, there's a lot of state programs if the need is big enough. And a lot of them have trigger points. They're not going to do it for one or two people. But if there's a trigger point, how do we then get so that it's not a question of, well, who's going to pay for this? Because there are funding sources out there to make that happen. The partnership necessary to lead the way, I've already talked a lot about this, I don't need to belabor that again. And then the workforce development coordination, the education component, bringing it down to the younger ages. So the third piece that we're going to talk about tonight is everybody's favorite, target industries. I'm going to start by saying I think we've identified a wide variety. There are a lot of, I told you, fundamentally we're in a good position here in Boyle County. So I think there's a lot of opportunity. The challenge is, A, there's nothing that's going to set your world on fire, unfortunately, if you think there's some magic bullet out there. And number two is, the reality is, we're going to have to pick and choose what we pursue from a resource perspective. Because to be able to pursue each of these individually is more than we can do with our current staffing and financial capacity. But these are all opportunities that are out there with you. What you're looking at here is a three-dimensional graphic, if you will. The size of the bubble is the total number of jobs. The location, left and right, is the concentration of jobs compared to the US. And the up and down is whether or not it's been growing or declining. The thick black lines, man, I should have had my laser pointer, that's very embarrassing. Excuse me, I'm just gonna carry this with me for a moment. I apologize if I'm blocking your view. But the thick black lines are zero. So this is where we have about the same concentration of jobs as the US, more and less. This is, it stayed stable, decline grew. So to give you understanding, and then of course, as I said, the size of the bowl indicates how many jobs we have here. I will say that as you can see here, the largest bubbles, or most of the largest bubbles, are white collar occupations here in the community. Healthcare, lodging and dining, retail, trade, information. Manufacturing is still a predominant part of our community, but probably not as it was once at one point in time. But that is not unique to Boyle County. That is a national trend, and frankly, a United States trend. Maybe not so much in some other countries in the world, but there are ethical issues there that we're not going to get into this evening. The reality is, though, luckily for us, it's not just about how we're doing. It's also about how our region is doing. And here you're looking at, this is what we call our surrounding market, the six counties that make up our immediate neighbors. And you can see the importance and the growth and the opportunity in the manufacturing sector that they have seen. I mentioned to you already, and I will say it again, you're being boiled by your neighbors. They're providing access to the same kind of amenities that you can provide cheaply. And so it's not necessarily we shouldn't be going after manufacturing, but once again, how do we set ourselves apart and focus on the type that we want and be very effective in that world? So what are our target industries? You can see here, and I'm not going to belabor this, the factors considered to identify what those clusters are. Strong local and regional presence is important. Industries that have growth potential, for me to tell you to go out and get something that is likely going to die in the United States in the next 20 years doesn't help you at all. Identifying targets that are consistent with our goals and standards here in the community was also something that we took into account. And then businesses that can capitalize on our strengths. How do we identify the types of industries that would want to be here? I will say, from my perspective, is when you start getting involved with financial incentives, you're running down a slippery slope. It's one thing to provide a capital incentive to make the operation more profitable initially. It's another thing to get involved in operational subsidies. And those are the debt, because you can never get out from under them. Because what that business has shown is they can't succeed here without intervention. I only say that to say that when we looked at this, we looked at businesses we think that will be able to sustain on their own. Whether you help them get here or not, they'll be able to be successful here in the community. And they're not going to constantly come back to you looking for more or threatening to leave. Now, I will preface that by saying sometimes global economic factors happen, and there's nothing you can do about that, as we have and are experiencing here. But the reality is, we try to focus on ones that could be successful here, all things being equal. I wish I could tell you what the economy would look like in 5 years. I'd be insanely wealthy and living somewhere in the Caribbean. Rather, I just don't have those skill sets. And so we're going to have to go by looking at where we think it's going to go and being as smart about it as possible. These, yet again, are also not in any particular order. It's the order that I created the slides. So please bear with me. I'm not saying this is the most important, town's the least important. Technical research and consulting and corporate operations. And you can see here a myriad of different types of businesses that operate in there. Really what I'm saying here is companies like mine that aren't location dependent, job opportunities, telecommuting, stuff like that, where the employee gets to pick where they live and they can work for someone anywhere. And then businesses that don't have to be near their clients on a regular basis have a lot of opportunity here. These are smaller, 0 to 50 people at most. I'd say you're probably gonna have much more success in the 0 to 25 range. But these are the types of companies that will look at our quality of life, our resources, our assets, and wanna be here in the community. There's a lot of opportunity to pursue this type of development. It's really not, a lot of it is not industry specific. People provide information services across all different spectrums, but it's something that you can do here and serve a client somewhere else. You look at Steve Chandler, you look at myself as easy examples. I could be here if I weren't married to a woman who wouldn't be here because she's a lobbyist and we need to live in the Washington, D.C. area. But the reality is I could operate my business here, Steve could operate his business here. Selling this community to people who value this quality of life and this community, this is an opportunity that we have to continue to pursue. These are some of the other part I will point out on this one is it's not always just the lawyer or the accountant or the economic development consultant. It's also the support businesses that serve them, is to make sure that you have in place the pieces that they need to be successful as well. You can't ignore that support piece, because just because I can locate here, if I can't get the resources I need to do, I need an accountant. I don't do my own accounting. If I can't find a good accountant, then you're out of the game for me, because I don't have the knowledge or the capacity to do that. So some of the steps, you know, simple things: inventory our available space, marketing our existing space to smaller firms. One of the things I'll say is we need to take a look at, I know Hart & Danville has already jumped on this, is inventorying our upper level space that is currently unused and seeing what it takes to get it operational. Because office users are okay with upper level space. They don't need the street traffic to get there. And how can we not only provide a space for them to locate without having to build new per se, but it will help activate our downtown, which would be a tremendous asset as well. Work with Center College on connecting majors to internship work study opportunities. I think there's a way that you can incent business saying, you know, you're an accountant, we have a finance degree, we can provide you with 3 interns at whatever rate you need to help during tax season. That's an asset that can be sold. So how can we tie together the resources we already have here in the community to be successful? BCTC, same sort of thing. And then long term is, how do we rehabilitate some of those existing buildings? I will tell you that some downtown buildings are probably ready to go today. Some are going to take a phenomenal amount of work to get them up and running. And so focus on the ones we can do now through the inventory, so we know what is the first phase, but then look at some of those problem children in the future. Local and regional distribution. I already mentioned earlier the fact that I learned, but I already had this up there. I did not create this after I learned our geographic center in the eastern United States. But it's an asset here. And to me, one of the best things we have to sell is an active, successful, with capacity rail line, a 5,000 foot runway that can land jets, and our proximity to major transportation, and by no small measure, the UPS's Express World, or whatever they call it, over in Louisville, is a tremendous way, they're not shipping it themselves, to tap into that. We are connected to that. There are tremendous opportunities to make this as part of our economic development strategy, the logistics. And it's not just a physical place to store my widgets, it's the companies that plan that. It's the technology people that help make sure those pieces are moving around where they need to be. It's, for example, at the airport, how do we expand their ability to become a regional hub for aircraft maintenance? If I'm within 65% of the population, 75% of the wealth of this country, within 500 nautical miles, it makes sense that if I have a fleet of corporate jets, I fly to the center point because I can serve a lot of markets and reduce my travel costs to get those aircraft repaired. So that goes into as part of that local and regional distribution, that logistics. It's not just I need to warehouse all these microphones until I ship them to the end user. It's a larger, I forget who does the We Love Logistics commercials on TV, but I mean, I say that to say it's a reasonable understanding it's not just the physical products moving is what's tied into logistics. So some of the actions, primarily invest improvements in your existing inventory to meet the needs for modern transportation. They like high ceilings, they like wide bays. To the extent that we can modify them, we can, but to make sure that if there's a particular standard they're looking for, our buildings are up to snuff. Marketing efforts to potential target businesses, enhancing investments in the fiber infrastructure. Especially if you want to go down that back office, you know, brain center of it, you're going to need to have that asset capacity in your community and high speed. I'm not saying you don't have it now. My concern is, do we have it in the places where they're going to want to locate the business? And if we don't, you know, what in the industry is called the last mile, there's the first mile, the middle mile, last mile. Sadly, the last mile is usually on the backs of the local community. And so how do we make sure that we have those assets in place in the places where we want this type of growth to go? And I would give one of the examples for me would be the airport. I do not know if it's served, but if not, it's an opportunity to expand the potential for that to be a location for additional logistics investments. Identify needs of firms to help and develop spec buildings. I would say for our community, in my opinion, a 25,000 to 50,000 square foot building as your first one out of the ground is probably your best bet, subdividable into 5 or 10,000 foot bays. Once again, it's scale. I will not sit here and tell you to go build a half million square foot building. That's probably going to sit here for 3 to 5 to 10 years to be filled. Let's look at facilities that we know that there's a market for, and so that we can make that move forward. This is not about the public sector doing it. It's about coming up with a strategic plan of how we can put together the public and private sector to mitigate everybody's risk, but to have the asset in place so that our industry recruitment isn't, oh, somebody left, now you have something to go sell. Or here's an empty field, sell that compared to the brand new spec building that's over in Harrisburg or over in Lebanon. I mean, it's hard to do that. It is very hard to do that. And if we're not in the game, you know, it's going to be very, very challenging to find that success. Create better defined strategy to market air rail goods movement. Continue to cultivate relationships with Norfolk Southern, which is something we actually have a meeting with them tomorrow to talk and see from, so I can learn firsthand and maybe identify some more specific opportunities that way. And then focus on the logistics along major transportation corridors and regional transportation connectors. There are some parts of this county that don't have much economic development going on that have a lot of potential. And I will be the first one to sit here and say, it doesn't mean open season on everywhere in the county. Let's work with our various community groups that have a vested interest in this and find out something that makes a lot of sense. Because there are some locations in this county, particularly for this type of use, that would be better off than on the bypass. And so how, well, number one, can we make that happen? And number two, if we can, how? Advanced manufacturing. This is an opportunity, when you look at it, particularly from a regional perspective, is being successful. And I will point out ones that we saw are wood production and transportation equipment. I don't think I need to explain to you the transportation equipment one is, but the challenge there is they don't always want to be in a 12-foot ceiling height, 14-foot ceiling height building that was built for a very specific use 50 years ago. They're going to want the space to be able to be created in their own image. And so how do we make that happen? I think that this is a tremendous opportunity we have in the community to reverse the ties that have been going on. But once again, it's about making sure we have the resources in place. And this kind of goes through our marketing and recruitment efforts. And this is about the shotgun or the rifle approach. This is about identifying what specifically we want to go after and go after that. We can't be all things to all people. So if we want to be plastics, if we want to be transportation equipment, then let's focus on that and go whole hog at it, rather than saying we're just gonna sprint, you know, throw everything out there and see what sticks. I think you're gonna have a lot more success and you're gonna be able to leverage those dollars much better, being a little bit more strategic about what you do. Collaborate with the region and the state on marketing trips. I believe you already do that now to a certain extent. Hopefully we can free up the staffing needed to do that more and identify opportunities. Lobby the BTC for the expansion and funding grant, like I talked about. I think that's important. Invest in improvements in the existing inventory, and this is before there's a prospect. If there's a challenge with an existing building that we've identified through other prospects coming through, let's get out ahead of it and fix it, and then put it in place. Whether that's through a soft loan or a low interest loan or a depreciating or a forgivable loan or something where it's not necessarily we're putting all the money up front, but let's put performance measures. We'll put up the $500,000 if you commit to being with us for 10 years. For every year less than that, you give us back 10% of the money that we put in. Reasonable businesses that are looking to be a partner with your community and not just trying to take advantage of you, will be okay with that. Because you're getting out of them the return you want for the investment, and they have to pay you if they fail to meet their expectations. This is what I'm talking about. It's not just giving away resources. It's about being strategic and getting what we want and making them be a partner with us. I told you about the 25 to 50,000 square foot building. And expanding our partnerships, in the last one, the long term, which is expanding our partnerships with regional Kentucky-wide industry leaders to keep up to date on changing needs of the industry, you're going to get a lot more support and help from your regional and state agencies if you're going after the same things that they want to go after. And so, from my perspective is, you don't have to do what they want to do, because that's what they want to do. How can we influence what they want to do through our own efforts? So how do we become a player where the Danville County EDP is helping the Kentucky Cabinet for Economic Development define what those priorities are? And becoming a larger player in those, that decision-making process that can benefit both the state and our community that meets what we want to try to accomplish. Healthcare and institutional, hopefully I don't need to go too far down the road in understanding why this is a potential opportunity. I mentioned earlier, it's not just about more docs per se, but it's also about some of the support things. We have a lot of golden years, folks that live here and want to live here. Well, they're going to continue to age, and they're not always going to be able to stay in the house that they're in. So if they need a place to go, and some of this is already happening, I'm not saying it's not, but there are opportunities there. And for those that do want to stay in their home, how do we create those home health care hospice types of businesses so that they have that choice, so that that opportunity is out there? But there's also child care, community care for the elderly, or the needs community. Those are also opportunities out there. There are folks that have those challenges here. You want to be able to provide people who live in this community the opportunity to get to be part of your success. I know for my wife and I, without childcare, we would have been sunk. Because you can't exist where I live without two working individuals in the household. I would argue you probably can't exist without having at least one working person in the household. And so how do we make sure that we have the pieces in place from a healthcare and social assistance to make it work? And then finally is, the one that I think will require a lot of coordination with Ephraim McDowell is research and support. Diagnostics, imaging, R&D. As Ephraim McDowell wants to, I said it both ways just to cover myself in case I mispronounce it one way, is that you can't tell you I didn't pronounce it right because I said it both ways. As they grow, what their business plan is should be embraced by the EDP, and to the extent that we can, help them grow, but also help influence it. If we want to see more R&D, we want to see more diagnostics in this community, work with them and say, we want to see this, how can we help you make that a reality? You have a partner in place, which is a wonderful asset to have. How do we take more advantage of that and go beyond just healthcare, but within the healthcare industry? I've mentioned that the Ephraim McDowell, I know that there's a tremendous nursing program, I believe, at Center. That's an, you know, I've continued to grow and build that. Maybe I'm misremembering that they have a program that gets you into nursing school. I forget, but I know that there's a connection between a program in nursing and Center College. I apologize, John, if you're in the crowd or if you're ever going to watch this, for not remembering it perfectly. Surveying the private practitioners in healthcare, once again, understanding need, and not just trying to guess what the need is, but understanding the need of your actual businesses and the people that are looking to grow your healthcare industry and making that part of your strategy. Entertainment and recreation, I believe this is the last one. And this goes back to someone earlier mentioned agribusiness, agritourism. It wasn't in the goals, but we did address it here. Everything from growing our entertainment in our downtown, in our downtowns, if you will. This is not to exclude the Perryville community that recently passed their wet laws, which opens the opportunity for them there as well. Entertainment, increasing the entertainment in our downtowns, not just dining venues and retail businesses, excuse me. But also the entertainment factor. One of the ideas that we've seen success is virtual reality gaming facilities. You go in, you know, if you see any of those Galaxy, Samsung commercials where people wearing those masks, is how do we parlay that into an economic development opportunity? How do we create an asset in our community that becomes a sets us apart, that becomes a destination? So it's taking advantage of those types of opportunities, if you will. Accommodations, bed and breakfasts, boutique hotels in the downtowns are opportunities there. I think we learned last time our hotel market is very healthy here. There's no sign of that slowing down. How do we tie into that? And then tourism. And that's everything from how do we weave together our existing resources like our museums and our theaters and our arts community into a more polished, more well-rounded marketing strategy to how do we go to agritourism? How do, for example, how do we now have a distillery in our community? How do we tie into the bourbon trail and all the money that that generates from people like myself who are bourbon fans? And then nature tourism. How do we take advantage of some of the parts of our county that likely will never see a lot of bricks and mortar development, but have tremendous assets that can be brought into the mix? And one of the things that comes to my mind is the birding area out in Forkland. Is how do we create a strategy that lets them be part of the success in a tourism component? So some of the things to do there, working with existing entrepreneurs, identify ways to facilitate additional investment. I know we have the Jumpstart program. We have visions of really, you know, juicing that up and getting it on steroids. Recruiting locally focused retail for Perryville, you know, identify opportunities. How do we take advantage, for example, of what I just said? Implement the recommendations in the branding strategy. When I know they're not finalized yet, but of the pieces that I've been able to see through communication with Steve, there are a lot of wonderful things that not only do I see as benefits for growing your tourism and your arts community base, but there will be tie-overs to create a more holistic marketing strategy for economic development as well. Your downtown boutique hotel concept, I think there's an opportunity there. I know there's been talk about it already, but it's worth reiterating and reassuring, I think, that that's an opportunity. Connections between event venues and tourism packages. This is one, in small communities like this, is really how you can jumpstart or really see growth in that, is creating length of stay. And we may not be a power of 10 community yet, but we are a power of 5 community, and we might not get a 5-day stay, but we can get a 2 or 3-day stay. And the economic impact of that overnight stay is substantial compared to the day trippers. And so how do we then create those cross-marketing strategies? Once again, this isn't about recreating the wheel, it's about being a better coordinator between the assets that we have now and getting everybody to pull in the same direction. And then assess the feasibility to expand attractions. There's everything mentioned from a large competitive sports complex to an expo center, all ideas that I think should be looked at as potential opportunities because they do draw people in the community and will help grow that length of stay opportunities. I will say though, and this is kind of a bailout for me, what you need to do is feasibility studies against those. Is that if we invest X million dollars into a sports complex, what is the reality we're gonna get 25 traveling sports competitions that'll bring in 500 people or 1,000 people that will stay at our hotels and spend money at our restaurants? There are specialty firms out there that do that, that in all disclosure is not part of the study, but something that you should be pursuing. And there's a number of those opportunities I think we've identified. So with that, that's a lot of information in a somewhat reasonable amount of time. I apologize if this was long again. It's a lot of information to cover with all of you, and I will say this is my PSA for tonight. My job is to give you the information you need to make informed decisions, is to help guide you to make decisions that are going to be not just in the best interest of the fiscal responsibility of this community, but the economic.
I think it's wonderful information. Only one problem I have is you've covered so much stuff that I wish it had been so we had it broken down in about 4 sessions. But I don't think that any of us here will take away more than 10%.
But we're all going to get this material.
Yeah, absolutely. And this information is available to everybody to digest. And once again, I can't stress to you enough, if you have questions, I am at your disposal to talk about those questions. Don't feel like if you go through and you say, oh, I wish I would have had Kyle explain more about this, that, or the other, that too late. I recognize the fact that it's a lot of information in a short amount of time, and I am available to you. That's part of, hopefully part of the reason why you guys hired me, is that I'm not here and then gone. I may not be physically here, but my phones work great, and I know yours do too. Huh?
What is your phone?
Well, my office line is 703-739-0965, extension 1. So after you hear the melodic voice of my business manager, press 1.
And I do want to add, we're videoing this. And when Kyle leaves town, we send out to all partner boards this videotape as well as the presentation. So you can sit at home and watch this over and over and over if you want to, because it is a lot coming at you fast.
If I may,
yes, sir.
One thing that you may have touched on or may not have elaborated on is the fact that we're a community that's attractive to a lot of folks for a lot of reasons to want to live.
Yep.
I don't think you touched directly upon any need to maintain or improve our quality of life issues necessarily in this presentation. It's what we're going to do to market the existing and not really a discussion of what further improvements might be warranted or that type of thing.
Well, I appreciate that. I would say my primary response to that is those improvements are inherent in the additional success that you have from retention, expansion, and recruitment. You want to see better, more diverse retail, for example. Retail follows rooftops. We create jobs, people come to the community, retailers want to be here. And so there's a lot of that is intrinsic. Growth of your arts, tourism, agribusiness is building upon the quality of life that makes Danville County unique and attractive. Putting in place the services that as we age and as we want to locate here for retirement helps benefit the quality of life and the needs and grow it. I recognize someday somebody's going to be taking care of me. I may at that point in time wanted to have that happen in my house. We need to have the business in place to make that a possibility. If we don't, then that's not an option. And you're either relocating to a facility or you're moving out of the community altogether to go find that somewhere else, which is ultimately not what the goal is. With that being said, is one of the things I also stressed about scale, which I didn't make apparent, but is also important, is that also helps preserve and grow that quality of life. Is as we focus on organic, what I call organic growth, doing it 10 jobs at a time, 20 jobs at a time, 30 jobs at a time, it allows you to manage the growth so that it's not such a shock to the system. If I put 1,000 new jobs in here tomorrow, that's going to have substantial effects on your housing market and change affordability almost overnight. I'm not saying it's a bad thing to have 1,000 more jobs tomorrow, if you understand what I'm saying, but it's about doing it in a manner that is in the best interest of the community, not just from a, once again, not just from a financial perspective, from an economic perspective.
Sustainability.
Absolutely. Yes, and that's the other thing is small companies tend to be more invested in where they are located. There was a number of people I spoke with that said, I started my business here, my business is nationwide, but this is my home. I'm not leaving. Try to get the CEO of Johnson & Johnson to make that claim try to get a CEO of Panasonic to say that the quality of life matters where they locate their facilities. I don't mean to make digs, and Panasonic, if you're watching, I'm sorry. But the reality is that I say that for point. People will figure out solutions to the problem in their community a lot more when they're invested in it than if it's just a long-distance corporate decision-making process.
And to follow up with that, the millennials are moving to cities where they want to be and then either finding jobs there or they're able to work from home and live anywhere. So even if they want to live here, we don't have the jobs for them. Is that fair statement?
I would say you don't have the diversity of jobs to make it attractive for everyone. I would say you do have jobs, but I say it's a pick and choose.
Right.
And then to add to the complexity of that is choice. There are other communities that offer those jobs too. And maybe Danville is not the place I want to be. Maybe I want to be in Decatur, Alabama, for example. And so there are that type of competition as well. So and that goes back to why I said, let's define what makes us special. Let's try and create a strategy that sets us apart. So not only are we attracting just the general millennial who says, I really love Boyle County. You know, there's been a number of stories about Center College graduates coming back here. But you become known to millennials as a place to go if you want to be successful. To me, that's the difference between reactive and proactive. We can sell quality of life all day long and hope the millennials that see that as a value come here. Or we can create a situation where millennials who fancy themselves entrepreneurs seek you out. You understand the nuanced difference of where I'm trying to go with that? So that to me is, from an economic development perspective, that's the opportunity. We want to grow that pie. But that also goes back to also having the type of housing that they're looking for. Most 20-year-olds, at least that I knew, weren't really ready to mow lawn. I know I wouldn't.
Well, and millennials don't necessarily want to be homeowners.
Exactly.
Oh, the statistics are overwhelming.
And yeah, yes. They are.
They saw their parents go through the housing mess.
Yes.
They don't want to buy a house.
I equate it to people who grew up in the Great Depression and their money saving and investment strategies and how they differed from mine growing up in the fat 80s. I have a much less risk averse view on my money than someone who was 10 years old in 1929 did when they were 43. And you're right. You make a good point, Mike. The kids who were 10 in 2007 that are now 20 saw potentially their parents lose their home. And so that stays with you. And so there probably is a generation that's going to have a bit different investment focus. I bring that up only to say that how all these things are tied together. And that's a quality of life issue. I don't want to own my home. I want to live in downtown Danville. What are you going to do to make that happen for me? You could probably count on one hand how many apartments there are in downtown Danville, if I had to guess. And so how do we then affect that so that we can be more successful in that arena of economic development? Does that make sense?
Right. And so the trend has been center graduates come back to Danville to retire. So what we need to do is figure out how to keep them here after graduation.
Yeah.
And on top of that, as far as home ownership, some millennials don't even own cars.
I was going to say that's going to be a taller order for this community, only because you don't have the public transportation network in place to make that. Now, I'm not saying that it can't happen. I'm just saying that for my economic development dollar, I'm going to spend it elsewhere than on that market segment, if that makes sense. Yes, sir.
I'd like to take Denise's comment a step further. We talk about center graduates, I think we got to talk about the people who grow up here. I'm talking about where they start their first school year, because the citizens around me make the investment in their education when they write their property tax bill.
Absolutely.
And we want to keep those folks here after they get out of school, whether they end up going to a trade school. Not everybody's built to go to college, or UK, or what, Eastern, anywhere. They're not all built there. We have changed that thought from where it was some years ago. Our return off the investment of educating them through the years comes when they become a productive citizen of this community, and they are paying payroll taxes, and they are contributing by maybe home ownership and paying property taxes and investing in it. That's our return. Well, we don't get it till we have an opportunity for them and their family to come back here.
And I'm going to wrangle in the conversation about the question Ron asked earlier about that is, one of the reasons why we see the value in going down to the middle school level to help connect to job training opportunities and jobs that are here is, it allows people who are being educated here a path if their goals aren't a 2 or 4 year college. And it also helps address the quality of life as well as the crime challenges. You're giving them an alternative. You're giving them an alternative that can be born in productive success rather than destructive success.
One other question I'd like to ask, and I don't know if you've gotten into this, but I get confused about growth, the population growth down the road for Danville, because I think in Ball County, I think it's important that we've got to be willing to grow. In your communication with different citizens, and based on numbers that you see, do you think Danville, number one, wants to grow? Number two, do you think in projections that you see this community growing? Because I see some surveys that do not talk about growth, and that affects an awful lot of what we're talking about tonight.
All things being equal, without us influencing the market, I don't see, other than retirees, to the point I think someone made over here, is there's not a whole lot of reason right now. If we allow, a lot of projections are based off of what's in the ground today and where they think it's going. Economic development is changing the paradigm. It's taking, I understand why projections may differ from what we see as an opportunity, because we're looking at how do we change that to affect why this community would or would not grow. So I'm less concerned about what a projection says what's going to happen, because they're not taking into account the influence of the investments, human, political, financial, community that we're making to change the dynamic. So that's the first answer to your question. Second question is, which is a very interesting question, which just you as a community will have to address, is there are components of this community that are very happy with the exact size it is today. And there are components of this community that are very supportive of it growing and expanding opportunity. And when you look at things, and we talked about this last time, the amount of space a business needs to perform its function per employee is substantially different than it was 30 years ago. I'm producing in an office environment that's substantially smaller on a per square foot basis than would have been considered acceptable in the 1980s. It's not that I have any more people or less people in my business. It's just people are more accustomed to working in, we're more efficient. And people are more accustomed to working in an 8x8 cube rather than a 15x12 office. I bring that up to say is, you as a community are going to have to figure out what you want. Because if you want to stay 30 some odd thousand people, I think I'm pretty close, if I'm not on target.
As a county.
This is a Danville Boyle County study. If you want to stay 30,000 people, you're not going to have a whole lot of economic development opportunity. Because you bring jobs, that brings people. Especially when your largest growth segment right now are people who don't work anymore, or are very soon not going to be working anymore. Even if you keep the same number of jobs you have today, you will see your population rise.
You made my point. There was a time in the 70s when this community, in my opinion, did not want growth. Growth happened because that's when manufacturing really started to roll in, and it changed the face of this community.
For the better.
For the better.
And my point to that is, you as a community have to decide how big you want to be. I argue the scaling, organic growth, which brings sustainability, also allows you to do that at a pace that's not going to seem offensive and is sensitive to the fact that there are people looking at this going, I don't want to be a 100,000 person community. I don't want to be a 250,000 person community. I moved here for this reason. I can tell you in Old Town Alexandria, where my office is located, I've had conversations with people that said, I moved here when US Route 1 south of the Beltway was a dirt road, and that's what I like. And I said, you're 6 miles from the nation's capital. That doesn't exist anymore. That paradigm that ship has sailed.
We as elected officials get faced with that.
Absolutely.
With that choice, and we have to make those decisions with the assets.
Well, the alternative is to look at them and say, fine, we won't grow. We're going to raise your taxes about every other year. Yeah,
that's the decision that we have to
Mr. Kaywood?
Yes.
If I told you that this was going to be easy, then I apologize sincerely.
No. I think we need to let everybody know.
Yes.
All the ramifications of how A affects B affects C.
And thank you for proving the point as to why I give you all as much information as I do. Yes, sir.
Let me take that and shift it just a little bit, because you made a comment maybe in one of our conference calls, but talking about the composition of the community and planning and zoning and how we have to come to some decisions about how we're going to grow and deal with the planning and zoning issue.
Yeah, well, I mean, we are blessed with land assets. We don't have unlimited land assets. And so we have to look at not just what we have today, but what makes sense for 20 years from now and 50 years from now, and plan around that. We as a community may say, and there have been sentiments expressed to me, the land that's been identified for commercial development is all the land that should ever be identified for commercial development. And that is a valid perspective to have. You need to understand the ramifications of that perspective. And if you as a community are okay with that, then that's the direction that you go. I would argue, and I'm biased being a development economist, that the long-term sustainability and success and viability of a community is continued growth. There's no such thing as this. from an economic development perspective. You're either this or you're that. You want your quality of life to stay like this, then you, from an economic development perspective, have to be going like that. To say, we're good enough, we're sustaining, it doesn't work. Building assets age. Market preferences change. Deferred investment is a reality when your building and assets get old and are non-competitive. If we're not continuing to feed the monster, if you will, then we run the risk of abject decline. And it will be slow. And see, this is the part that I try to imprint, to stress to my clients. It doesn't all happen in one day. You won't even realize it. It's like growing old. I woke up one morning and my back hurt every stinking morning. And I'm like, when did this happen? I used to be able to jump out of bed and run 5 miles without even thinking about it. Now it's an effort to get to my bathroom. It happens glacially slow, and so you don't feel it. My point is, it's easy to say, oh, well, we're okay now. So we're just gonna stay where we are. But I put to you, as the elected officials, is you don't have the luxury of looking at today. You gotta think about 20 years, 30 years, 50 years from now, because decisions you make have that influence. And so, to your point, Mike, is yes, we have to make some decisions on how much we wanna grow, and where are the most appropriate locations for that to happen, and then put in place the policies that it's not all going to happen tomorrow, but we have identified what we're going to do over the next however many years. That's my perspective. You don't have to rezone everything today. In fact, I would encourage you not to do that, because then you'll create unnecessary competition within your own community. But you do have to identify that someday this is a good location for whatever it is. And that goes with the residential piece as well. It's not just non-residential development too. You have to identify where that makes the most sense. Yes, sir.
Yeah. From what you've studied and looked at us here and kind of playing off of your question, would it be fair to say that this community would probably like measured growth and quality growth, not just boom, a whole bunch of growth?
Yeah. I think that's fair. Part of the reason, by no coincidence, I'm stressing the scaling. Not only does it make sense from an economic development perspective, it fits within the goal of we want to maintain our quality of life and the character of our community. It all fits together.
And I think going along with that, the type of industry or entrepreneurship, I should probably use that instead, that we want to attract to this community needs to see that. Opening the floodgates and letting anybody in.
From my perspective, one of the best assets you have is that near retirement community, because what I've learned about baby boomers is they don't want to retire. They want to semi-retire. And so there's an entrepreneurial business development strategy there. They also don't mind being mentors to people who do have the energy to work 60, 80 hours a week. And so we have a resource here that we can tap into that's free that can help build that as a strategy. It's not even 8 o'clock, people. We're still way ahead of the game.
You're just that good.
So, I'm sorry.
I do have a quick question.
Yes, sir.
So I'm wearing my variable hat today. How do we take some of the information that you just shared there and disseminate it down to a level that our community of 600 people can also be a positive part of that implementation partnership?
You have assets in your community. You have a successful area, a bed and breakfast business. You have Merchants Row that I don't think has maximized what its potential is. You have some businesses there, for example, that are doing very, very well with online internet sales. They've expanded their market. I think, from my perspective, that's where Perryville's bread and butter is not just serving the local population, but how do we create that destination within the community that is unique, that doesn't require Perryville or even Boyle County people to consume at it. You have the battlefield. It's taking those assets and applying the goals and objectives and the strategies here to say, how do we maximize what the battlefield can do for us? How do we take advantage of the alcohol vote we just made and create a whiz-bang destination dining facility that will thrive in Perryville because we got Louisville's most renowned chef to come and open a restaurant here. That will draw people from 30 miles, 50 miles, people from Lexington will come to eat at it, so they get access to it. It's taking what we've learned and boiling it down to what is the priority for Perryville that works within a realistic, viable strategy. And then having the EDP help meet that vision.
I remember going to Midway 30 years ago, maybe 35. The railroad ran right down through Main Street. And I remember looking at the empty building. Go to Midway today. Very top shelf restaurants. People travel everywhere from Danville to go to Midway, and that's not necessarily an easy drive. So,
I mean, to that point is, I have spoken with some folks in Perryville. We have additional conversations that are going to go on tomorrow afternoon, tomorrow evening. But it's, for example, one thing that was brought up to me was, how do we get a better retail presence here in our community? And I would argue that you have the infrastructure in place. Now let's create the strategy. How can the EDP help create, for example, a virtual mall for the retailers that open up in Perryville so that you can market well beyond the community and thrive where you would say, well, you know, that business shouldn't be successful if you look at where it's located. I think there's opportunities there. There's examples of that in a number, you know, you might point out there are examples of that in a number of communities. Merchant's Row is a really cool place. It's a really cool place. How do we maximize the benefit of that? And frankly, the community's made a lot of investments there too. The state's made a lot of investments there. So how do we take this and make that work better for us? Is that, am I answering your question?
Yeah, I mean, that was my question.
Okay.
How do I take that?
Well, it's focusing on businesses that can be successful, that can take advantage of a global or national market rather than just a local market. It's working with the EDP to help set up that online presence so that it's easy for people. It's coordinating the businesses that are there with the new business that come in to create a single point of access. You shouldn't, if you have eight businesses, it shouldn't be eight websites. It should be one website that you don't even know which retailer you're buying from. You don't even have to say, oh, this is from Joe's, this is from Bill's. You say, this is what we're offering. You pick everything and everyone brings their goods and they ship it off to the single person. I mean, Amazon does it on a global scale. Why can't we do it in eight buildings? I mean, but see, that's how the EDP then plays a role, is how do they help you set that up? How do they become the conduit to make that happen? And I really do believe, by the way, in that high-end destination restaurant. In my brain, it's a locally sourced, you know, nothing is bought from outside of Boyle County, Mario Batali-esque kind of nameplate that sells alcohol, that brings people into the community.
You're talking to the guy who's working on it.
Yeah, he's working on it.
I don't care if he's the guy who wants to take it from the guy that is working on it. To me, it's the vision of the economic development strategy, because if you only build an Applebee's out there, it will fail in days, because you don't have the market to support it. The retail analysis showed that. So how do we create then the environment where we grow our market? It's what I call growing the market. We're not selling to Perryville or even Boyle County. We're selling to everywhere from Bardstown to Lexington and beyond. Does that make
sense? No, that makes perfect sense. I mean, you know, when we, and I'm doing the restaurant in Perryville, and one of the things that people have been asking is, are you going to make something in Perryville that's going to suit the people that are in Perryville? Well, I still have payroll. I still have taxes.
Lots of taxes.
So, you know, I still have lots of taxes. So the challenge is convincing people that yes, I'm not necessarily going to do a restaurant that's going to be just for the people that live on 2nd Street in Perryville. I have to look outside that parameter.
I would argue that you are building it for them in a manner that it can be successful.
Right. Yes.
I'm making a semantic change that removes the confrontational piece of it and makes it a collaborative piece of it. You need to educate them saying, from a business perspective, no one's going to loan me the money to do this if I tell them I'm just going to be serving these 600 people. It'll never happen. They'll never get a restaurant. And that, I believe that is a realistic argument to make. than saying, but what I am doing is creating a restaurant that we all can enjoy in a manner that's going to bring in greater activity, because we're doing it in a manner that, that makes us unique in the marketplace. I know it sounds hokey, and I appreciate that, but to me, how you say things is, you know, my wife taught me this after yelling at me lots. It's not what you say, Kyle, it's how you say it. And I don't like your tone of voice. My point of the story is that you're both saying the same things. There's just confusion. So rather than engage in an unnecessary debate where you agree, is let's bring it to a common ground. And I believe that also is relatable to the EDP as a whole. To jump up on my soapbox for a moment.
Well, I think the most fascinating part about this is, you know, as we sit and listen to all the different pieces and parts, there are parts that don't necessarily pertain to me personally, but there are parts of it that I have a huge passion for. And while I can't possibly go through and implement every piece of this, I do have a responsibility to help with a certain part.
You have an opportunity. I would argue it is an opportunity to do it. You know, you're only responsible for what you agree to be responsible for, but you have an opportunity to do lots of things. And so, once again, it's a small semantic change, but it takes it from a negative perspective, saying it's your job to do this, to, hey, you can do this if you really want. And I think people, we are all social creatures by nature. We all respond better to the positive than to the negative. I tell my children that they have to do it, but they have no power, so that's their problem. When you're dealing with other sentient beings, the positive approach is usually the most, much better one.
So we talk about Parable a lot. Is Junction City a factor?
I think Junction City's greatest opportunities are around the airport. To be honest with you, for me, is how do we create economic development around the airport that will benefit Junction City? I think, to me, that's their best opportunity. The challenge I have is they have been non-responsive to our overtures to participate. Doesn't mean we're not going to continue to express overtures for them to participate. It just hasn't been accepted yet.
Is that with city officials?
We have made overtures to get Johnson City involved, and we're hoping that they engage soon.
We had some contact today. It was encouraging. A couple of their elected officials wanted to attend tonight, but were sick. But again, we're the more of us who can engage in this, the better.
It's probably one of our most hidden diamonds in the rough, if I'm not sure. A lot of people in
Brooklyn
don't even know how terrific
that
airport is.
Lauren and I took the 30-minute tour for an hour and a half.
Where you were starting.
And it was
you just got busted because that's on camera.
I said we took the tour. That's all I said. You were all speculating on everything else. So that was all on the rest of you. But first of all and foremost, it's a 5,000-foot runway. And that opens up all sorts of doors from aviation because you can land jets, which is a huge, it changes the game. That's the first thing. It is centrally located where businesses see the value of using it as a hub if your business operations are Eastern United States. It already serves as a distribution facility for manufacturers in this region. Most people don't know that. And so the opportunity is there. The question becomes is how do we take advantage of it? How do we build that relationship so that we can then create a partnership? And if you haven't heard me say that yet, shame on me. I say that to a blue in my face. I'm not standing up here sick today and saying everything's going to be hunky-dory tomorrow because Kyle said so. There's a lot of work in building and rebuilding those relationships. But if you don't, the partnership's going to be impossible to come by.
And the other factor about that airport is it's undeveloped on three sides.
Yes. And there's a inter-county partnership opportunity there as well. That I know it's not my job to plan economic development for Lincoln County, but my advice to you as my client in Boyle County is there's a lot of opportunities to partner. And for example, can we do a joint industrial park where we both invest in the strategy and we both reap the benefits? There, I can point to you a number of communities that have done joint investment strategies and economic development growth. That's one that makes sense to me, at least for us. Next time you better have three. I'm wearing you guys down.
Bro.
Yes, sir.
Could you possibly just briefly describe the remaining processes that we will be going through? The timeline.
Absolutely.
The remaining processes.
The next time we get together is synthesizing all the feedback that I'm collecting this trip, because we're doing a lot of focus groups. One of the big focuses this time is talking with the individual member boards of the EDP. So the next time we get together is the framework strategy for implementation. Taking all this, you saw some of those initial ideas, building back feedback I got from you, build back feedback I get from the strategy committee, and come up with a straw man that we're all going to walk through to get your feedback. Okay? Part of what that is, and my point of bringing up the member boards, is organizational framework. And I know that's a big one here. And so we're going to be looking at what, if any, recommendations do we have on in creating a more efficient and effective economic development effort, an organization. And that gets back to the who does what, and when, where, why, and how. So the next time, we're effectively done with the data piece of this. If there's specific questions you have that you want to clarify next time, I'll do that. But we're now moving into to what I call the fun part, which is where usually we part ways as friends. Because the reality is, implementation, Mr. Kaywood, is not going to be easy. And it's going to be a series of compromises and very hard decisions by everybody. And that's usually where, I usually don't get arms folded sitting back until that meeting, but apparently I've done something today. I tell you, this is a tough community. I've been struggling with arm folding this entire process. So, but I mean, to that is that getting into some strategies, opportunities, recommendations around what should we be doing. The other thing we're going to be bringing back next time is potential economic development sites, physical locations that we think, or areas, I should say, that we think have the greatest potential, which may not be necessarily looking like today, but need to be considered. And then tell me why no, and I'll tell you why yes, and then you can make a decision. Yes, sir.
What kind of time frame are we talking about? Because we all start budgeting process in another 30 days, if not sooner. And
you don't have a date.
I don't have a date yet.
Okay.
I would hope
well,
that would be,
because part of what you're talking about has to do with our budget.
And oh, yes, sir.
Assets. So we're about ready to enter that stage. And so
did I tell you that this was going to be easy?
If I did, then I apologize.
In your next meeting, are you going to have any tidbits about where to get this 100-150 million that we're supposed to come up with to do implement about half of what you're talking about?
We will be talking about funding strategies, yes. We're not going to have a hard number next time because it's a framework plan. Right. I want your feedback on it first before I start saying, well, this is what then we're going to do. It just doesn't make any sense for me to throw a number out at you when stuff may not even make it past the cutting.
Well, you know, we talked a lot about the airport, and I made a little joke. It wasn't meant against Stuart, but Stuart's a fine man. But he has spent 40 years building this airport we've got.
Yes.
He's done an absolutely fabulous job in having it where it is right now. But right now, he will tell you real quickly, as he has done in our meetings, he doesn't even have enough hangar space for the aircraft he's got.
Correct.
He doesn't have enough anything for the aircraft.
He has substantially
world.
More demand than he has supply.
Exactly. His demand is big. And to expand that airport to probably double its size is kind of what he's indicating. You're looking at a $10 to $20 million project. I mean, you know, where are you going to come up with all this money? And I think it's great if we can do it, but you've got to have an answer where you're going to come up with this money.
We're going to prioritize. Because a lot of stuff is going to have a price tag attached to it. We recognize that all that money is not available today. But we're going to have to prioritize. Stuart,
the financials for the city and the county.
Stuart is a wizard at bringing in grant money. to do things on his airport. And I say his airport because it's actually named after him.
It is his airport.
I know he doesn't own it, but for all intents and purposes. My point there is, we need to build a relationship with Stuart. Say, this is what we're going to do. And Stuart, what resources out there available for us to do that? Because I guarantee you, he has connections that will help mitigate some of that cost.
Local government only has about 10% of the investment out there in the airport. Because he's got
I respect that.
He's done a great job.
And in reality, what I'm delivering to you, if you remember from our first conversation, is the menu. There's going to be 8 appetizers and 15 entrees and 7 desserts. And you're going to have to pick from that based on the priorities that you establish as a community. I know. When you look at those goals, forget about the rest. Just look at those 9 goals. The investment to hit success in every one of those goals is substantial. I recognize that we're going to have to prioritize and figure which are the ones that we're going to pursue first and which ones are the ones we're going to have to delay. But remember when you asked me about metrics and I said, you need to measure what you do and is it being successful, and if not, you move on to the next thing? This is what the strategic plan is. It identifies the 8 next things. So that if you don't feel that you're being successful here, let's try this. We are not getting the type of return, economic return, and I will argue with you all night long on that. But if we're not getting the economic return we want for this investment, what other opportunities do we have? So, absolutely. But we're not going to be talking about hard numbers next time. That'll be the time after that. However, I did commit to Ben to have the pieces in place by April 1 to have a good sense of what the cost structure will be so that you can incorporate that into your fiscal planning. Correct? I'm not misstating that, am I?
Yeah, the EDP board today talked about our budget strategy given where we are in this process. To your earlier point, John, how are we going to make sure this syncs up? So it all comes to a conclusion that makes sense.
Well, we're working on ours, and everybody needs to know what, you know.
Yeah, so what...
Barry's already working.
Yeah, what the basic spirit of your budget cycle starts in the March time frame, and you all lock it down in the...
May-June
time frame. We think we're going to be far enough with this conversation that we ought to be able to... articulate what the priorities ought to be, and then we'll get back to okay, who's got anything to help? Right. Which is the big question.
I want to thank all of you for continuing to participate in this process. I can't stress to you how important it is that the elected bodies of this community come together and hear this stuff firsthand. Because frankly, a lot of decision making is going to be on your shoulders. And like I said, I know it's a lot and it can be dense, but I need to tell you this stuff so you have it so that when you make decisions, you're making the most informed decision that you can. And so I apologize for the length of time. I really do. I just can't avoid it. There's no way to not give you this information because my job is to make sure you're making decisions based on the best information you can have. We may not agree upon them, and I expect and appreciate that. But I know that you're gonna be making them knowing the implications and the ramifications of the decisions that you make. And I will also say, I also know that there is no right decision. Because there's no, that's all good and no bad, and there's opportunity costs and everything that we talked about here tonight. So if I leave here with the belief that you guys are in a position to make the best choices you can for your community, I feel like I did my job.
Before we wrap up tonight, you go back to your slides. You gave us some slides with some data, some comparisons, owned by the government and developed by race. Could you go back to several slides so I can ask you some questions about that?
About what now?
Yeah, go back several slides. Oh,
It starts here.
Okay.
Actually, no, it doesn't. Starts here. This is the first one.
Yeah, okay. Let's look at that one. It says it's run by the 2016 Assets and Opportunities Report Card.
For the Corporation for Enterprise Development. It's the right. State Report Card.
So that's ranked in Kentucky?
Yep.
And it's comparing Kentucky to the rest of the state of Kentucky?
No, it's comparing Kentucky to the other states in the Union.
Okay, so that... So it says employee share of premium. And yeah. That means we have your rates.
Yeah.
16 out of 50 states.
Yeah.
And that's a good rating because you have 30 some states below us.
Yep.
Invest in
it,
right?
It goes to show that Kentucky is, the businesses in Kentucky tend to are on the better side of average in terms of the cost sharing that employees have to do to have health care. And that is an asset. And the point of me bringing this up, it doesn't really matter where Kentucky lands, it's an asset that you can sell to a business who's looking to come here and then sell, and then tie this into this, access to our health care that we have here in the community. I recognize that Bowling Green can talk about the same information here that you can.
Sure.
My point is, I start here and then I whittle you down to get to the most important pieces.
The next question is about education. No.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yes.
Well, all of that. 4-year degree by race. We're the fourth in the nation.
Yes.
And has to graduate from race. We're the ninth in the nation.
Yes. Like I said, there's a disparity between your primary and secondary performance and then moving on to the next level. Because if I move down to here, 4-year college degree, 48%. 2-year college degree, 47%. We have a wonderful primary education system. We have a population that doesn't take advantage of post-secondary education as much. That has an influence from an economic development perspective of that skews the types of companies that are going to want to be here. Now, Danville, Boyle County, with things like Center College and proximity to Lexington, you buck this trend a little bit. But if I am Kyle Corporation looking to locate here, I'm not just concerned about people who live in Danville and Boyle County. I'm concerned about where I'm going to be drawing my labor force from.
Yeah.
So for me, the importance of talking about this is, this goes back to how do we get into your secondary and your middle school level and prepare them for jobs where if you need a 2-year college degree, by the time you're 19, you between your high school courses and 1 year of training, you're ready to go. And we have now created an asset in our community that very few other Kentucky communities can sell. I say this all to say is, this particular piece of data isn't as important to me as how it fits in with all the other pieces of data. And I did my best to try and explain to them how they all work in unison.
Well, I'm an educator.
Yeah.
So that slide and the slide before that, that's some of the data.
This one? This slide and the slide I just showed
you? Yeah, it says high school graduation rate, we're ninth in the nation.
Yes.
And then you go back to the next slide. And
yeah, but how do you correlate that with reading efficiency drops to 18?
That's a good number.
Tell us anything?
That's a good number too. But
I know it's a good number, but why would you go from 9th to 18th in those two
years? Unfortunately, and I have three of my four parent figures in my families are educators, and sometimes people move on through the system without ever meeting the expectation.
Absolutely.
And so that's why you can see disparities between the two.
I understand, but the 18th on that didn't work.
Well, someone asked a question, why is there a disparity? And I'm explaining the fact that sometimes people move through the system without ever achieving the grade level expectation.
And Kyle, Kentucky's rate popped up there as soon as we instituted state law to require you to attend till 18.
Okay.
That was just 2 years ago.
Okay.
Yeah. It's
2-3.
Yes. And dropouts do have an adverse effect on stuff like graduation rate and blah, 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 blah. Which then, to me, if you're one of the few states that have a requirement to 18, the fact that you're only 9th, you know, I'm not saying it's a bad thing. I'm just saying the fact that you're only 9th
Well, it looks bad.
Before that, it was drastically different.
I'm with you.
If I go to the high school degree, it says Kentucky is 46 out of 50 states in our students getting high school diplomas. But the sidebar to that is that the state that is number 15 might just be at 60% of high school graduations. We may be 46 instead of being just 5%
below. Absolutely. I can't stress enough, you should not read anything into these individual numbers. Mm-hmm. It is the confluence of these numbers that paint a picture to me that I tried to express to you here tonight.
And that's a bad picture for us. That's why I want to dig in deep and say, let's find out where the real...
Absolutely. Economic development is just not about taking advantages of your strengths. Sure. It's addressing your weaknesses. And so I hope to this point, and by the end of it, you understand how I don't talk about negative. I talk about opportunity.
Sure.
I talk about challenge, because it's not that it can't be fixed. And there's if you put certain things in place, some of that stuff, which might be a statewide issue, will no longer be a Boyle County issue. You give a kid at 13 years old an opportunity to make 50 grand a year by the time they're 19, and it's real, and they can see it and touch it and feel it, that completely changes the conversation at home. I've seen communities who've done, I say this because I've seen communities who have done this, and the type of success they have.
I apologize for taking you back to this last
year. There is nothing to apologize about. I want to make sure that you are on board and understand all this stuff so that when you make your vote and your decision, you're doing it understanding the context of all this.
Yeah, was it reported? I take you back because it reported something.
That's too funny.
It didn't take me a little bit of time to get to that point, but they all know why it took me that long.
Any other questions? I realize, I mean, I'm not flying home until Friday morning, so you guys might be here at 12, I'm good. I just need to be somewhere at 7:30 tomorrow morning. I know that that's the next thing on my calendar. I want to thank you all yet again for being here. I can't stress to you enough the importance of all you being here, participating, and hearing me drone on and on and on. The benefits of your community will reap from this goes well beyond what I can express to you. My clients that have been the most successful in economic development are ones where the elected officials engage and engage with an open mind. Because if you are okay with understanding that what we might be doing is not the right thing, or what my preconceived notions may not be the most accurate, I think that's where the communities where they've been able to pull together and really change the dynamic for their economic development efforts. So thank you. Thank you for being here. I appreciate our next time. I know that the EDP will be in touch with you about certain dates. And I do apologize that we probably will be going into budget season. So we'll have to load you up on some caffeine pills before we start.
Start a little earlier if you're going to.
Thank you. Thanks again.